Hello guys, hello, we are here, we're ready, the stream is up, the local recording has started. This is the ESL 1 New York Southeast Asian qualifiers. We're into the semi-finals. I'm Dirkit in the JD Studios, and oh my goodness, it has been a morning, my co-caster Blaze is here, I hope there are no more problems. I think you're on that button now, aren't you? There we go. Hello Blaze.
How's it going, man?
Phoenix, oh my god, please. Please send help. Right, whatever. We're in the game. Picks have started. We're going to forget about the nonsense that happened this morning. Bounty Tusk banned out. Gyro Lesh taken out by MVP Phoenix. But we've got ourselves Undying Ember and Darkseer up against PL, Dazzle, and Wyvern. So far, both of these drafts seem pretty well balanced. You know, good team fight orientation, good laning phase. But Ember against PL,
10 seconds,
maybe you
remaining.
Start to look at this being sort of aimed at being countering
five
that Phantom Lancer.
Yeah, and it's kind of interesting here because there's a lot of potential for the Ember Spirit versus the PL in the later stages when the Battle Fury is online, but Undying is a support that doesn't really go to that end. He doesn't really want to say, hey, let's take the game 40 minutes and then we'll have a core advantage. He wants to be involved in early fights, or early objective control, and really get the ball rolling for his team. So by going for the Darkseer Ember Spirit, they certainly secure their late game stage, but Undying is still going to be trying to put out pressure early on, and I'm curious what support they end up going to couple with that. Maybe something like a Witch Doctor could be pretty good for that double sustained push through their heals. I'm sure they wanted the Dazzle, but that was sniped up by MVP Phoenix when they went for the PL, which, although it's not great against the Undying because of Soul Rip, it's actually pretty good against the Tombstone because of the Doppelganger. So a lot of ways to look at it, but it should be a pretty active early game from both sides.
Oh yeah, I'd love to see the Witch Doctor here. Just throw that cask out. It's, you know, going to stop those PL illusions from running around too much. Death Ward, a little bit negated by Winter Wyvern's Cold Embrace, but it doesn't last too long. And if you're embracing someone in the middle of a team fight when there's a Death Ward down, you've got some other serious issues to handle. Now, TNC, they do love their 10 sort of 15-minute timing hit, where all of a sudden maybe they lose a laning phase, maybe they do okay, but it's always around 15 minutes. They say, right, we've got some items, we've got our levels. It's quite often when their support's going to hit level, you know, 7, 8, and their cores are up to level 9 or 10, then they realize, okay, we need to go and take Roshan, objectives, towers, and I think that's what they're aiming for with this lineup. Darkseer, obviously, his laning phase is incredibly up and down. Against these supports, though, he should have an okay time. There's no one really to stop him from getting experience and gold, no one to actually lock him in place. He's always going to be able to surge away. So he should be able to get a reasonably fast mech up. He'll get his levels. And there's Lina to zap down the Shadow Fiend as well.
Phoenix's turn to ban.
Yeah, and I'm surprised, honestly, that Lina got through to this stage in the draft. Going to be the fourth pickup here, and obviously the SEA teams have a different drafting style. There's a couple heroes that are much higher prioritized in this scene than in other ones, but the Lina, very surprisingly, just hasn't been touched whatsoever. So now she gets picked up, very strong combo with the Vacuum and the Lightstrike Ray, and of course a very flexible hero. But in this case, it seems her role is a little bit clear. I would say that she's going to be focusing as a support in the safe lane and mostly just trying to get her levels up and try to help zone out with her long attack range. Now, how this all fixes it together, I'm guessing they're just going to leave the Darkseer solo because he's not that strong of a dual lane hero, and they're just going to prioritize getting to level 6. At that point, they should probably be grouping up at least 4 heroes at a time to try to actually push some towers down and get some control over the map.
Yeah, I noticed that over the past week or so, the Lina isn't first pick, first ban like she is in Europe. It's been kind of refreshing to see. She's very often picked in that support role, especially for TNC. AU love that support Lina and kind of treat her as a fourth core. Now, this hero from MVP Phoenix, though, we haven't seen the Watermelon in a long, long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a pretty powerful hero. Not really great against some of these guys. Like, it used to be really good against Undying because you could anchor smash the zombies. Now that's not the case, so you're really looking at breaking out of disables with the Kraken Chill, so you're not going to get comboed by the Lightstrike Array, the Ember Spirit Chains. Those kinds of things are going to be maneuverable. He's going to be able to always get that ultimate off, of course. But I'm trying to think of how he kind of really gets involved other than just your standard Blink Dagger or Arcanes. I've been thinking about this hero a lot, and I've wanted to draft him more and more, but it's really hard to actually justify it, just because it's so easy to zone him out. If TNC is good about controlling the Ancient stacks, then Tidehunter in general is just going to have a lot of issues. So We'll have to see if he can break into that mid-game timing, and also if they can kind of use their map presence to make up for his lack of ulti cooldown. Because essentially the biggest way to exploit a Tidehunter is just to fight between the Ravages. If you can accomplish that, then he's going to have some trouble.
Yeah, also, if you look at the bans from TMC, Spearbreaker and Clockwork, both of them fill a similar role to Tidehunter. They don't have the massive AoE you get from Ravage, but you've still got longer initiation, you know, charge and hookshot forward. You don't need to spend 2,250 gold to get your initiation tool.
Sven,
you have it innately.
Sven's ready.
And TNC come out with a Sven. Oh, boy. Now, we saw a bunch when they had Teehee still playing with them. They'd play Sven, Phantom Lancer, Klinksmith. They'd have all these kind of unusual mid-heroes. But here, I'm wondering if this is going to be some kind of aggro dual lane, or even aggro tri-lane.
Hmm. I mean, it's definitely possible to do that. Put the Darkseer in kind of a 1v1 instead, and that could be pretty good. Right now, though, I think they're mostly focusing on how their team fights are going to play. They're not really as worried about their lanes as they are about what's going to happen after that laning phase breaks down. And right now, they've got a lot in this Darkseer. If this Darkseer gets a Blink Dagger relatively early, maybe he still goes Guardian Greaves first, but still gets a Blink Dagger next, you can combo it up with so many abilities on the side of TNC. You can get a Stormhammer on 4 or 5 heroes. You can get the Lina Lightstrike Ray on multiple. Like, you have so much potential setup. And it's going to be on MVP Phoenix to really space themselves out and on the Shadow Fiend to farm up a relatively early BKB against this team.
And this is a support Sven that's going to be cleaving through PL Illusions, going to be throwing out these Storm Hammers and trying to deal with him that way. Now, Ember mid, Noji is on this Lina, so he's actually okay. And this is one of the things that always confuses me a lot about TNC, is their role switching.
Yeah.
Because they just switch every player every which way. Like, yesterday, Noji was playing the safe lane carry, you know, Gyrocopter, things like that. And X-Lucky was playing Earthshaker, playing that sort of four-role support, holding behind. But now they've switched things up a little bit. Noji looks like he's on the support Lina, so it is going to be that four-role Lina with AU on the Undying, just running around with the Orb of Venom and Stout Shield, causing a little bit of havoc. They have gone down towards this bottom rune spot, though, looking for some kind of engagement here with MVP. March is on Tidehunter, Heen on that Dazzle, Febby, Winter Wyvern, and QO Shadow Fiend. Not the usual hyper-aggressive heroes we see from QO, but he's definitely adept on his hero regardless. And Mind Protector on the Phantom Lancer. And they're just walking themselves around, kind of... This is what I was talking to X-Musica about yesterday, is the mind games around bounty runes. And especially when there's an Undying on the field, or you definitely feel that TNC has the level 1 advantage here. With their stuns, with their tombstone, with Iron Shell, it's ridiculously good. Usually you'd expect them to go top rune, contest, and the Radiant just go bottom rune. But here they've just kind of switched it up. But that's on the part of MVP. They've realized that they have moved down to this bottom lane, and it's not worthwhile actually contesting that.
Definitely a good call to make sure the Shadow Fiend gets his good start. They're already going to get a healing salve off that courier as a result of the bounty rune. But the swap here is actually pretty interesting for the side of TNC. They kind of still seem like they're a team that's trying to get a feel for how they really want to run their roles as we approach the majors here. There's still a few of these members are relatively young to the team. Only the past couple weeks have they been on the roster. And another thing is they don't, like you said, they didn't have a Gyrocopter this time. The last 10 drafts for TNC have been featured the Gyrocopter played by Najee there, so the fact is maybe not having that available to them, not being able to trade those bans, makes it a little bit less comfortable for them, and they do end up giving him the support Lina.
Yeah, no Queen of Pain either, which he's been known to pick up from time to time. Now, the dual lanes out here from MVP, PL plus Dazzle are up at top, up against this Sven, so X-Lucky does have... he's got an okay time leeching experience, but he's not going to have a great time getting last hits in there. The bot lane, though, TNC Undying a Darkseer, and this isn't a dual lane I've really seen before. Actually, Spirit Breaker Undying, Phoenix with the zombie guy, but March, oh man. If Sven's having a tough time getting last hits until Noji comes in with Alina, March is going to be stuck behind his tier 1. It's a good thing as well, though, because Sam H is pushing this lane with Iron Shell, so you will get experience.
Yeah, even still, he might be forced off the tower pretty well. This Orb of Venom and March is in a really bad position here. He's going to be able to tank either through the tree line nicely, but generally speaking, this Undying is going to be able to punish March pretty heavily because of all the spells to negate with Kraken Shell, an Orb of Venom slow is not really one of them. The Zombie slow, the Orb of Venom slow, they persist whether Kraken Shell triggers or not, or at least they'll be reapplied immediately thereafter, and that means that it's going to be very hard for him to get away if he gets caught out, and he has to play extremely safe under this tower, just pretty much not leaving its range if the Undying's anywhere nearby. But AU will rotate around a little bit, cover up the bottom rune, and actually go for a stack that the Darkseer will most likely take advantage of in the near future.
Money to burn.
Oh, nice little move there. The one trouble here, though, for TNC is that their middle lane is not doing well. He's got his bottle up on this Ember Spirit, so Raven, he's got that going for him. But the Winter Wyvern, who sat mid for a good minute and a half, 2 minutes or so, has completely shut down this Ember Spirit. Three last hits, while the Shadow Fiend has 14. This has not been a 1v1 lane, and he really hasn't had any help. Lina has been basically stuck up at top, looking to try and harass out the Dazzle, keep the PL on the down low a little bit. And Winter Wyvern, while Febby moves up to top lane, this Arctic Burn could open up for a kill onto Sven if he's too far forward, but he backs himself up. He's fine. Gets behind the trees. And Raven,
so?
Forced back by the Shadow Fiend. Look at that. Trading hits.
Yeah, and that's a really hard thing to do as Ember Spirit. You look at this matchup, and 9 times out of 10, the Shadow Fiend's going to win just because of the raw physical damage advantage. He's got attack range, and he's building up his Necromastery, which means the one armor Ember Spirit is in for a pounding. But in this case, Raven is really getting involved in the lane. He's still getting destroyed in CS, but at least he's kind of giving his best effort to not be completely marginalized by the Shadow Fiend's presence. It's not really helped out that Febby, twice over now, has put pressure out on Raven, and once more is coming to the lane for this Arctic Burn.
Look at this triple stack they've got. they stacked it one more time. Sure, it's Mud Golems, but that's Sam H now up to level 4. Marge comes across and he's just eyeing them. What are you doing in my jungle? How are you doing this? But with the Tombstone, it just opens up the jungle for them. Uh-huh. TNC take full advantage. Now, middle lane, Raven, the replacement for Teehee. This was like the lane that a lot of fans of TNC were incredibly worried about, mainly because Teehee was their star player. He was the guy that would win his lane, kind of like, the Filipino version of Sumail. He'd win his lane regardless of matchup, regardless of heroes or players or whatever was happening in the game. And when he left, Raven has actually stepped up to the plate. He's done exceptionally well yesterday. He played an Ember Spirit where his laning phase was pretty rough, but he just didn't die. And that was the key factor, I think, for him. Not dying, keeping your farm rate just continually ticking over. Not losing out on gold, not losing out on experience. And every little nuanced play he made with the remnants, with the spirits, it was just inch perfect. So we'll definitely look for that from him this game. Like right now, farming the jungle, knowing that Winter Wyvern, Shadow Fiend are a little bit missing off the map. QO went down to the bottom rune spot to get a regen rune. But Raven doesn't feel safe there. He's taking full advantage of this little jungle stack that's made for him.
Yeah. The big deal here is TNC knew that they would be struggling in that lane in particular, and they're just going to make up for it through heavy stacking. He'll be able to flame guard that down without too much difficulty, and he's going to be making every safe play he possibly can. But in the meantime, that leaves QO to just build himself up. He's in a really good spot in terms of early CS, and is even keeping pace with the Darkseer, who's got that jungle access as well. So some really good stacking from the Undying, but the SF is still right up there with Big Sam H.
That Arctic Burn comes in. Febby takes Raven down to half HP with a raise from QO as well. It's not a happy time for Raven on this Ember Spirit still, but March has hit level 6. I think that's a key thing to take away from this lane. He has got his experience up at top. Lucky he's being dived a little bit here, but turns back with a Storm Bolt onto MP, and now with the Warcry. He just fends him off, sends him back, and now maybe a little bit too ballsy. He's gone into that creep wave, but he's got the armor, he's got the HP, and he's got 7 wand charges to keep himself healthy. Down at bottom lane, Febby is watching over March as well. But where does this Ravage come into play? Because TNC, their group up and push and fight doesn't come for a long while. So I'm going to be seeing this Ravage used for, what, one kill? Maybe on an Ember Spirit? Maybe on that Sven up at top lane?
Really also depends on when Febby's able to get out of this experienced trench that he's put himself in, because Winter's Curse is actually a pretty good spell to actually set things up. You can get in position for the Ravage, and then right when the Winter's Curse ends, do maximum damage to all the heroes in range, and that'll definitely extend your Ravage's reach prior to the Blink Dagger. But the problem is, this Wyvern is 2.5. He's been so focused on zoning and roaming that he hasn't been really able to do much for himself, and now you see he's just going to sit here and leech as much as he can from that mid lane while they continue to put pressure on Raven.
They're farming this jungle. Like, this will never cease to amuse me. AU and Sam H both in the jungle, mm-hmm. but they clear it so quickly with the double iron shell. It's just straight through the jungle camp. They lose out on what? One? Yeah, one creep from the wave. That's all they lose out on.
And you'll note that three members started with Stout Shield on the side of TNC, and now four have them, and they're making full advantage of them on the bottom lane. Both these guys having Stout Shield means they don't pretty much lose any HP from the stacks that they're clearing, and it just makes them so cost-effective. Now you've got Soul Ring, a single Ring of Regen, and the Arcane Boots on the Darkseer, and they can just continue to spam. So they're farming, they're fighting. And, we got a DD rune on QO, so I think they're going to start putting some major damage in this tier 1 tower.
Yeah, March is here as well, so there's going to be no real contest. Noji will try to spam out the wave, but that level 1 Dragon Slave on the support Lina, not really going to deter. QO with that DD, with the catapult behind him. Glyph, you know, just slow them down a bit, but the trade-off is there. Down at bottom lane, the tier 1 down there is actually going... Whoa. What? Blood in the
water. He actually ravaged him. He was able to get the ravage off while Ember Spirit was in a tough position, didn't get the Fire Remnant away quickly enough, and it's an awkward position to be in to die to a no-gush Tidehunter, but that's just what happened.
Radiant's bottom tower has fallen. Well, March Tide gets the first blood. Noji on the run now. He's got Darkseer and Undying behind him. Ray's not going to be hitting too much here. He now in the Tombstone. He's got his Grave. Let's use it right here with March on the run. Febby, the double Iron Shell, doing a ton of damage. Cuts through the trees, but the zombie still chasing him. Surged through onto this Undying, and they'll get a kill on Febby at the very least here.
Yeah, he doesn't have anything to really do about it, so he just spends a little bit of gold and will be going down. They still got the tier 1 tower, which obviously is really important, but it's still so... Oh, top lane, MP? Nah, he's got his doppelganger still up, so at least he's going to be forced back to base. But one thing that happened there with the Ember Spirit was Raven was just trying to be a little bit too efficient. Looking back at the combat log, you can see that he was jungling, and then essentially he just went for a Remnant and then a TP. So he just wanted to fuel up back of the fountain and then jump right back, and it was just a very dumb luck that March was able to actually catch him out of position, ravage during the TP, and get a free kill. So now it's 1-for-1, the first blood going to MVP instead of TNC, and I would say TNC have some ground to make up, especially since Ember Spirit has only a net worth of 2700 now.
Yeah, and this Shadow Fiend racking up the gold up to 1000 now. Sitting nearly at 5,000 net worth. March?
No, he surged the Undying instead of himself, and he just assumed that the Tide wouldn't go for the TP so early, but obviously the Vacuum's the only interrupt there, and he is able to get out just quickly enough. It looks like March will be going for the Guardian Greaves build himself, by the way.
Okay. So that way they've got three heals out, and it also opens up Shadow Fiend to go for something a little more aggressive, maybe. He could go for the BKB as his first item, but he could also go Shadow Blade, S and Y. I'm not sure what I'd prefer to see from here. If we do see the Greaves out from March, and he's 1v1ing Raven once again, dropping him low, getting him down to a third of his HP. But yeah, maybe a Blink on the Shadow Fiend. If you do have that Tide, Ravage, Winter's Curse, then Requiem to follow through, getting Shadow Fiend into position like that could be pretty big.
Yeah, a lot of potential with that. And otherwise, the one great thing about MVP's lineup is they're still really good at split pushing. The Shadow Fiend and the PL both do major damage to towers very quickly, and they're able to kind of just spread the lanes really nicely. They'll obviously have to start playing more carefully as the Blink Daggers start coming out for presumably the Darkseer and the Sven. That's still going to be a while off unless X-Lucky goes for it as his next pickup.
What does he have? They love their bottles on TNC, honestly. I've seen AU pick up bottles on support heroes a bunch. Not this time, though, on this Undying. He's gone Dazzle bottle first item, Omni Knight, Earthshaker. Like, before he buys wards Dyer's or boots or anything, just rushes into attack. That bottle. But Sven, with bottle and wand, he wants that lane sustain. He wants that mana regen as well, just to keep himself up and running. War Cries and Storm Bolts. Obviously, very mana-intensive hero with a relatively low mana pool. With the stun out, Tombstone is down. Gonna Shadow Wave onto QO, and they've got no way of healing up this Tombstone, so that's an easy takeout, and the Tier 1's gonna drop regardless.
That's a huge pickup there. Killing off the Tombstone and killing off the Tier 1 here, they have just taken the full map away from TNC. The only spot that Ember Spirit could safely farm was his jungle, and now that's gone too. So at this point, Raven's farm is going to be falling further and further behind. And you look at this guy, all he's got is Phase Boots, a Bracer, and 600 gold. Like, he is lacking so much, and there's no recovery for him.
Yeah, and MVP, they're on the full march forward. QO is going to go for that BKB, I guess. The old club kind of indicates that. Quite often, if you want the S&Y, you go for the Yasha first, then into the Sanctum Yasha. But March nearly has his mech. And the thing is, this push is coming before mech. The pre-mech push, the fact they've got the Cold Embrace, they've got the Shadow Wave level 3 now. as well as that grave to back up their retreat. Yeah. If that mech comes out in a timely manner, which it will do, he's, what, 300 gold away from it? Yeah, basically.
Radiance mid. Yeah, but Samich just picked up his mechanism as well, so it's going to be kind of equaled out as far as which team wins out as far as the fights go on. I think the Dazzle brings a lot to the table in the longer fights, but still, there's obviously a lot to be said about avoiding that big ulti wombo combo from the Tide and the SF when you can just mech up and kind of reset the fight. So, yeah, both sides obviously have some benefit to it, but overall, I don't feel that the mechanisms change the game nearly as much since they come out about the same time. One really interesting aspect of how this is progressing, though, is that we still have a level 4 Wyvern, we still have a level 4 Lina. Either one of those ultis could really enable things, but right now, all they can do is really leech stacks that are being farmed. For example, Febby and March over at the Ancients, and actually, we're going to see a smoke come out from the side of TNC.
Yeah, an interesting smoke partners as well. No Sven plus Lina. They don't have the Storm Bolt into that Lifestrike array. So let's probably start things off here with Syrian Chains into that Stun Remnant. Forward, MP, Doppelgangers away. But he doesn't know who's coming up behind him. The Tombstone with the Chains. They'll get this kill. They'll take down the PL. That's a pretty big one as well. Because he's racking up the gold. He just finished off his drums with Aquila Brown Boots. And next up, probably your Booty Travel. And then there's a Diffusal Blade. Stopping him now. And getting that little bit of sort of control on this bottom lane, you force Tide to TP, so there's not going to be a TP Ravage anywhere. You open up X Lucky at top lane to farm, and now middle lane, Raven. He can feel pretty safe in his jungle, just the fact you know you've kind of drawn MVP down to this bottom lane to defend the PL who, you know, died anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they've got great coverage over the map now, placing some good wards out. Looks like one will be D ward as the Tide pings it out, but even still, they are really taking control of this position, and this is what they need to do with heroes like Undying, that they get the potential to take such early advantages, and we saw some of that really work against the Tide, but I would say not enough to deserve the Undying pick so early in the draft. Like, this hero really wants to exemplify the early game, and right now they're actually being outpushed by MVP.
What do they do to combat this? Because the Phantom Lancer hasn't really been involved in these pushes. It's been the four-man push in, while PL farms pretty safely across the map. Raven spots him out, just a little slight and change there to make him well aware that this Ember Spirit's on his tail. Now the Mask of Mana from Sven. Before Blink, before anything really here. Just go for that straight up attack speed. Is this indicative of them wanting just to go in and fight now? Looks like they're actually grouping up to do just that. Sven has a TP. He's gonna have to start using it soon. Tier 1 is dropping a pretty drastic rate. Raven with his Flame Guard runs forward. There's a slight chains. Great onto Fabian March. But it doesn't really accomplish anything. With the mech used early as well. The Sven is not joining this fight.
Yeah, it's so difficult. I mean, we have the Winter's Curse right here, and the Tombstone going to be coming down. QO just going for the very early Requiem, and the Ravage from March will clip Undying in the tree line.
Yeah, but QO vacuum back in with Febby. Winter's Curse is down the grave. Everything just being thrown down into this fight. Febby down and out. QO still alive with the grave. Kills off Sven in the process of his own death as March is looking for the Anchor Smash. The Lance onto AU, still not finishing well, finally. Even though he decayed through it, and Noji going to be the third casualty of war here. As this Ember Spirit and Darkseer, they can't sustain! They do not have the lasting willpower to actually get through this fight. The PL, oh, he can't get there with the Lance, and Sam H TP's out just about! That was too close for comfort, though.
Really was. There was an amazing two-man Lightstrike array that had hit right when the Winter's Curse connected on the Sven. If the Winter's Curse wasn't there at the time, then MVP would have just lost the fight right there. But I'm actually seeing even more genius to the draft that came out from MVP. We do see MP in a little bit of trouble here. He's had probably the most trouble this game with such a low net worth, but he should be able to get away from just Raven, who's by himself. In fact, lancing him, this guy's out of mana, and March is coming in alongside AU. They're not going to be able to break down the Tombstone, and the DK will actually pick up the PL. March unable to TP away in time. So, unfortunate pickoffs there, and really not prepared for that exchange, but their overall 5-on-5 team fight, I still have to praise the brilliance of this draft, because there's one really cool aspect of it that we haven't really seen much of since 6.83, and that's the attack damage reduction based on a percentage. You have that from Requiem Souls and Anchor Smash, and when you stack those together, you actually have 110% base attack damage reduction, which means you mostly have to go for items like Daedalus and MKB in order to get your damage online.
Oh, Lina. Holy now, the stick charges, but the final ray is going to come out here. Got the final right click, in fact. Gets that movement speed. He did go for the SNY, not the BKB. We'll be going into the BKB next, but Samage back. Now the mech and the surge. We'll get him back to safety. But yeah, is damage reduction additive?
Yeah, these kinds of damage reduction are specifically additive. Anchor okay. Smash, the Hurricane of Souls, the negative Vengeance Aura from Vengeful Spirit, those kinds of things stack perfectly additively, but they only affect the white number, the base damage, whereas the green damage is kind of unaffected. Yeah. So what that means is that it changes how TNC have to build, and you're going to have to see, after the obvious basic BKB treads from the Sven, he's going to probably go more into like a Daedalus, because otherwise his damage is just going to be completely irrelevant when the Anchor Smash and Requiem hit him.
Yeah, you can't go for stats-based damage, you've got to go for that raw damage item.
Mm-hmm. And it used to be a lot more common in 6.83 because you saw a lot more like agility cores that went for Butterflies and Scotties and Sanjin Yashas and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, go for those stats-based items, but this game, Sven, let's see what he does. Middle lane, the push just... the onslaught continues. Qo up on the front lines, he's got the majority of the BKB coming. Oh, he's got an open cup. The BOT is actually for the Phantom Lancer. Only just Radiant's done, 18 minutes in, like you said, he's lagging behind a little bit here. With three heroes from the Dire up in that top four. The Dark Sire, he's up at the top of his teammates as well. 7.5k, but Ember Spirit, I think he's the real shining star here. He's managed to catch up a fair amount, overlapping the PL and the Sven to get himself closer and closer to that Battle Fury. This is what Raven does. Attack. Since that one death, the little fluke where March found him in the jungle, he hasn't died once, he's found himself four kills. He's managed to get himself a ton of gold. Now, okay.
Ah, that sucks. So the smoke comes out. Obviously, no Observer Wards in play. TNC, though, are reading the situation that everybody's missing off the map. So they have to have some suspicions. And you're seeing already, like, I mean, without any delay, they're pinging this general area. So they probably have some idea of what's going on, but they can't be certain until they actually throw, like, a remnant into the pit or something. Anyways, I'd still like the play from MVP, whether or not they're scouted, because as long as they don't get hit too hard by the vacuum wall, then they can still win the fight, because they have such good ultimates across the board for 5-on-5 Roche pit fights. All they have to do is avoid that Darkseer combo, and they're going to be in a good position to take the fight. Oh, whoa, I really stood by that statement until I noticed one thing. March actually doesn't have his TP off cooldown. He TP'd top just 16 seconds ago, or a little bit longer than that. But still, he has it on cooldown for 44 seconds, and he can't be involved in this at all.
Oh, dear.
Yeah. I thought that he had the TP to the tier 2 bot, and in that case, I think they have a lot going for them, but... We're just going to see them go for it anyways. The Medallion of Courage, the Presence of Dark Lord, and the double damage are going to make it die very, very quickly.
Yeah, the Dire have no idea. They've got a nice little Observer Ward up on the high ground, but doesn't see it to the pit. And maybe that was their plan. Maybe March going up the top lane was a little bit of a bait. Because who goes and does Roshan without their big AoE teamfight starter, right? Who goes and does Roshan without Ravage? Without Mech? Your big utility teamfight control hero. I think that's a little bit of mind game for MVP.
I believe originally, yes, but I do think that the Weave was actually visible. If they looked at the map at all, they would have seen the Weave in the area to the west of the Observer Ward, and they probably just said that we can't take this fight, because honestly, until there's a Blink Dagger on the Darkseer, I actually don't see a really clean engage for TNC.
Yeah, and before Blink, he's going into that hood, probably pipe, deal with a little bit of magic damage coming out, but what magic damage is there? Requiem, Razors, Ravage?
Requiem mostly, yeah. Attack. I mean, Ravage is something, but definitely not enough to really build a pipe for. It's going to be the Requiem that they try to avoid and try to tank through, and that's all well and good, but the Blink Dagger is something they have to have if they're going to be able to do anything against this Winter Wyvern.
Yeah, Blink or Glimmer Cape. Like, we've seen a ton of Glimmer Capes for the fact that it gives you that little bit of extra initiation power over that pipe. Sure, pipe's a little bit better for pushing high ground and is a decent sort of mid-game game-ending item. But when Sven nearly has a BKB, and this Ember Spirit, I guess his Battle Fury is pretty much done. He's, what, 400 gold away from it, because he doesn't have his Blowing Blade yet.
Tower is under attack.
Pretty good. Sven, with his bottle. Oh, okay. He's playing this like Eternal Envy. This bottle is going to be that late-game winning item, where you pick up a DD rune or a haste or something like that and chase people down to kill them. I think that's one of the like underrated things with carries, holding bottles. You know, we've seen it from Terrorblade, from Eternal Envy, we've seen it from Nagas, things like that. But a Sven here, if he does get one of these nice little runes, Invis, a Haste, a DD, whatever it may be, he can actually turn a fight pretty nicely with it. Obviously, originally it's for lane sustain, but he's keeping it now for a little bit of sneakiness later on. Mind Protector up at top, though. X-Lucky running straight for him, waiting for the Doppelganger here to try and stun him first, but AU comes in. There's the Decay and Tombstone. Stun, Doppelganger dodge.
Ooh.
It looks like he should be okay. Even
no,
with
he's
back-
got the backing back still. They're going to be able to keep him slow with the zombie, and he should be in some real trouble. They missed the wall, but one more hit will do it. And yeah, only get to Doppelganger once out of that one, and that just adds more to what was already a really difficult game for MP. I mean, you look at his last hits. This is a BOT Phantom Lancer that only has 113 CS. He's just been having trouble since the landing phase, and it's certainly not getting better for him.
Yeah, it's been pretty rough. Didn't realize that Darkseer would get into range, but that is obviously a level 4 vacuum. He's bypassed level 2 in Surge, which is pretty interesting, actually, because the, you know, the standard build that's actually gone for 95% of the time is
Radiant's
the 2 points of Surge. With now you go 4 points in Iron Shell, it used to be 3, but now you can get that double Iron Shell or triple Iron Shell out. A little bit stronger. QO with Aegis up on the front lines. He doesn't really care about the backpack from Zamage. And Raven, Battle Fury's done. But your tower's already dead. You're going to have to defend the high ground a little bit here.
Top tower is under attack.
Yeah, and that's with the PL dead. Like, they go in and just take the tier 2 no problem because they're so afraid of the ultimates and they just can't close the distance. So I think that's a pretty big factor here. As far as the max vacuum build, it's pretty self-evident with their draft. Like, it just makes so much sense when they're trying to connect with multi-man Lightstrike Arrays and multi-man Decays to try to emphasize that. But now AU is going to be in some real trouble. They're just going to blow the Winter's Curse early just to make sure he goes down. But the Requiem actually doesn't connect too hard. And Kyo's BKB is about to run out. He'll kill the Tombstone and head for the hills, but Raven here does get some good damage on Febby in his retreat.
Don't actually get anything done with that, and that's two big ulties down. A minute and a half without your Winter's Curse, and a minute and a half without your Requiem. Maybe more of a deterrent than anything, because the Sven was kind of running down the river towards them. They weren't sure where he was, but X-Lucky has been playing this counter-PL kind of role. Phantom Lancer hasn't been a part of these fights. You know, we've seen MVP Phoenix just run at them 4 versus 5 a lot of the time, or 4 versus 4, while MP is in this sort of split-pushing role. Sven has been countering that. He's been on the lane, dealing with the PL, while the Ember Spirit gets farmed, and I'm wondering now if Raven actually starts to switch things up. If now it's Raven's turn to go and do that counter-PL movement and allow Sven to go on teamfight for once, because he's got his BKB, with the Mask of Madness and the stun, he can set up for Lina, he can set up with the vacuum into Stormbolt. It's a pretty good team fight. And MVP, what's their response to this? How can they deal with a vac back into LSA, Decay, Stormbolt, and a big Tombstone? Well, maybe that's it. The Blink on March.
Yeah.
That Blink Ravage is up.
It just comes down to who pulls the trigger first. And right now, they have a Blink and TNC do not. So with Darkseid only having 1 point in Surge, he's not going to be really able to get the perfect vacuums if MVP have the right spread. And as soon as he gets in position for it, he might be hit by the Winter's Curse or the Ravage. And at that point, a lot of the potential is lost. So I still think that as quick as Darkseer may be, if he tries to initiate, he's going to be running into some trouble unless he has all four members of his team at his back.
Well, that's pretty nice for this Undying as well. We've seen him go for Crimson Guard a bunch in the past, and it looks like that's what he's heading into now. Medallion Arcanes with his Vitality Booster going to go into the Vanguard, and it's decent dealing with the PL Illusions, you know, physical damage coming out of them. Also, Minus Armor. It's not too bad against that. The Minus Armor they've got from Weave, from Presence of the Dark Lord. Damage block is pretty good.
Ooh.
Oh, man, this is risky. Noji, Lina, are you going to scout this out? QO just walked into the middle of two of them now. He's going to get chained up. Meanwhile, on the back end, what are we actually having here? Febby running over the cliff, and this is just... Oh, Ravage comes in onto three. March sets it all up with a Requiem. AU dropping low. The Tombstone's still there, though, stacking up zombies. Thanks, Lucky. Gets the hits down onto the Dazzle. But meanwhile, in the back into wall. MP and March deal with the Tombstone. Remnants come across, and Raven ready to fight. But is he? He's got no mana left. He's got no HP either. And with the Undying dead, the PL finally drops. March healed up by Heen on the back. There's no grave for 15 seconds. But the Darkseer running around the side while QO cleans up the Lina. And they know. They know Heen's up here. They know March is coming in as well. Maybe they can actually kill off. Nope. There we go. Jump back to the Remnant. And Raven is fine. Overall, that fight, TNC, they come out on top pretty heavily.
Yeah, it was actually quite surprising considering the beauty of that Ravage Requiem. But a big factor there is just how underfarmed the PL is. He's barely got his Diffusal Blade at like 24 minutes, and he really just isn't able to stay in the fight for very long at all. The other thing is Shadow Fiend took surprisingly long to take down the Undying solo. The Undying has right now 12 armor with this medallion. He's got a Vit booster and a Stout shield. He got, like, I think 3 or 4 stacks of decay and soul ripped himself pretty much to full HP. And this forced so much out of the Shadow Fiend that I would say QO attacked him 10 times at least in that fight. And that's something you can't really afford to have happen from your Shadow Fiend, who's doing all your damage for you right now.
Yeah, and the Shadow Fiend, when did Aegis expire, actually? Oh, it's, I guess it was like right before that fight kicked off?
Presumably, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I was just wondering if maybe they could have tried to bait out the Shadow Fiend death and then have the follow-through, but Aegis was already gone, so no point thinking about that. QO keeps on farming. He's got his BKB as well as an ultimate orb. Now, is this going to be Skadi, I guess? Just to try and slow down the Ember, kite him around a bit, but also Sven is the big one. Even through his BKB, Shadow Fiend with the Skadi is pretty good at just slowing that guy down, so he can't get the big cleaves and hits through. And that's why he's got himself a Blink Dagger. Reposition, and move yourself into a good little place. Good little spot for that Sam H. Darkseer to get the job done with him. Back you back into maybe the Sven when he buys a crit. We see the old fear from EG, the Dream League clip, where he crits through. I think it was Alliance or No Tidehunter. Killed like 4 in one hit. I've been waiting for that stuff to happen again. And where are they heading to? They know March is down the bottom lane. Tidehunter getting wrapped around on. He's got his blink and a TP. And he blinks forward into the creep wave. I think that's him done. Remnants forward, March. You're going to have to try and TP away somewhere super sneaky, but I don't think it's happening. You're dead. There's almost no chance of survival here. You know, he'll tank through it, but okay, the Laguna Blade even. The 5-man gank onto the March has bought a little bit of space and time for Mind Protector up a top lane to push into the tier 2. Sam H is here with the Ion Shell and Vacuum back. But now, ooh, what do you actually do? Because the PL, okay, on the run now. Sam H defusal bladed. Urge down. Raven TPs himself in. There was backup in the form of QO, though, right behind him. What?
Yeah, that's a really bad position to be in. Probably distracted by what was going on up top, and Febby just not really into his own play. He didn't do anything there but die very quickly. The Glimmer Cape unsuccessful in getting him away.
Where are they heading into now? I'm dying, no Observer Wards, so he's actually just walking up this cliff looking for someone to punch, I think. Hey, you? What are you up to? Tier 1 mid, still standing. Pretty valuable target to take down right now for the Dire. With 1400 gold on his Darkseer, Pipe Greaves Soul Ring. His Blink Dagger is really not far away at all. Oh wow, okay, Raven on the Ember, he's gone for a BKB. He's sick and tired of getting hit by that Ravage, getting burnt down by the Ember Spirit, by the Phantom Lancer. And I think that's the big reason. Losing your mana as an Ember Spirit against a PL with the illusion just stacking up, even though you are seen as a counter against them with Sleight of Fist, with Remnants to jump away, if you're in the middle of the fight, in the thick of things, you actually get destroyed by the PL.
Yeah, it can be quite difficult. Obviously, the illusions aren't really tanky right now. They'll probably die to like one slide or one great cleave, but that is going to be long-term a really big issue. And also, of course, he does want to fight during that Ravage, and you can't really rely on things like Sleight of Fist to dodge that out when it hits such a big area over time. So right now, he's in a great spot, has that DD rune bottled, which could be huge if they look for an engage. And I believe, yeah, they still have one smoke in bank, so they definitely could look for a fight if they're trying to make full use of that DD. Unfortunately, though, MVP are already in the pit, smoked up behind it, too. It's so difficult to engage in this position, but acts like it will try.
Oh, Tombstone's dropped as well. QO pops his BKB and just... Oh, what? Holy crap, okay, he cleaved through them both. I'm watching QO now, trying to battle up against the Sven. Kiting around with the Skadi, but Raven's still up and running. QO and March on the run out. TNC just reposition themselves, looking to try maybe to re-engage as MP drop low the stun onto an illusion. That's not the real one. Blink, Ravage gonna cash them, QO, Requiem, but in comes Lucky again. Raven's here too. QO's taken down the Lina. No G's dropped, but X Lucky, he's got the drums, he's got stick charges as well. Back into wall as Samage catches them. QO hit by his own illusion and dropping to the decay. Maybe finds a kill to AU and will do so. March finds that one, but Raven dying to the PL. He's searched up and Exilic comes in with that Warcry to try and save him. MP, there we go, sliced down, and this Sven, he is piling it on. Don't think March can really escape here. Raven just hiding in the trees, doesn't want to get smashed down. And March is surviving pretty well through this with the Iron Shell though, with the God Strength still up. Go take him out. And now Roshan, is it available for
Oh, and a regen rune. Jeez, Raven is so lucky right there. They are ready to fight Roshan at just about. They can bottle X Lucky. They can just go for it, and this is going to be huge. We're going to see Dazzle check out what's going on in the pit, but there's no way he can do anything about it. And, well, actually, they're still a little bit concerned, losing a lot of armor, of course, but these are two supports. I really don't know if there's that much risk unless you stack hard for that Winter's Curse. That being said, really, that team fight comes down to one thing, and that's the initiation from TNC. The Ember Spirit and the Sven alone were able to get a two-man Searing Chains into a two-man Stormhammer on key heroes, taking them down immediately. They couldn't do anything for that team fight. Without, like, Grave, like, what can you really do against this monstrous Sven? And I just gotta say that X-Lucky blinking into the pit and not even popping BKB until he saw a use for it, like, this guy really just timed everything perfectly, and they absolutely deserve every advantage that fight gave them.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I was watching QO getting stunned up, forcing BKB. Didn't see the insta-kill on the Searing Chains and stunned up targets in the back. Double blink out now, though, for the Radiant, Winter Wyvern, and the Shadow Fiend. So, Glimmer Blink on Wyvern. They've got, what, three blinks now? SF Tide and Winter Wyvern as they try to get in here to take down. That's Roche. That's MVP not in time. TNC have already got Aegis. Got themselves a nice little advantage as well. Vanguard is done for AU, so his Crimson Guard is not far away. And Raven? He must have something on the Courier, right?
Yeah.
He's got the Crystallis done. Same as the Sven, so both of them going for the crits, going for the heavy damage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the right way to build in this situation. You don't want, like I talked about, you don't want stats. You want to make sure that you get those crazy amounts of burst damage with a potential crit. And, of course, the attack damage value on all these critical components is really important as well. Demon Edge is a great item against the MVP composition. Even though, for the most of that last fight, they were able to avoid spells like Anchor Smash and Requiem by just jumping on targets that were isolated away from.
When they finish up those Daedaluses, what do you think they go into next? Something like an AC for the Sven, I guess? But Ember Spirit, his item decisions are a lot more open. You know, Lincoln Sphere, maybe. Against that Winter's Curse is a great defensive item, but you want to go damage here, surely. So maybe a Skadi to the best of both worlds, get a bit of damage, a bit of tankiness. Or do you want to look towards an MKB? Because it's going to be a butterfly for the Shadow Fiend at some point. And getting through that evasion is going to be pretty useful. AU, what's he up to? 1300 gold! This Undying is getting pretty rich. He's still behind that Tidehunter, but his counterpart is the Darkseer. Darkseer now with the Shiva's Guard. He's still the Mystic Staff away from it. Oh, I would have been super surprised if he had it fully completed. 33 minutes in, the Darkseer has had a whale of a time getting his farm, and that dual laner bot really did pay off.
Sorry about that small tech issue there, but. Pretty much have full confidence, I would say, moving into this next play. And another DD rune for Raven.
No.
The first DD rune, probably overkill, because they were able to clear out those two supports insanely fast anyways. But in this fight, it could be the difference maker. So, again, lucky for the having the bottle still, and getting another DD rune to use your BKB in conjunction with.
I really love this Darkseer Iron Shell combo with people. Like, you know, the vacuum wall is one thing. But it's something we used to see a ton from, like, European teams. Was I'm gonna jump in here? No. Was AA, Ember Spirit, and Darkseer. You'd have the Ice Blast, the Iron Shell, and the Flame Guard, and you just run at people, mow them down. You'd be basically a lawnmower as the Ember Spirit. MVP Phoenix, split pushing away. They know that there's a bunch of heroes from the Dire actually towards the middle lane. They get their push on, take down a tower up at top, and they push down bottom lane as well. They get that trade-off. As TNC forced to blink back and get themselves away from the Ravage because they're not all grouped up here. They've got a couple of people who went back to try and defend. Ember at bot, and now he's moving up to top lane. But who has Aegis Immortal? Sven.
Sven, yeah. So they really want to push with this as 5, but obviously the split push is making it quite difficult. The PL and the Shadow Fiend are really well attuned for this, and they're going to be in a great position now that the Manta style is just about up for PL, and of course the BKB blink's already up for QO. So they're really efficient at moving on the map without much risk, and the only thing that TNC can do to respond right now is just use the Ember Spirit to TP back and then run it back forward after he's done clearing the waves.
Yeah. He's got face boots and BOTs. The double boots from Raven. He needs both of them.
Value.
Yeah, gotta keep them. Until you get that next item, why not? We don't have the TP scroll slot wasted anymore. Sam H, what are we still building into that Shiva's Guard? Now, the Radiant, they've got a pretty damn good high ground offensive lineup here, so taking a team flight outside of their base is going to be risky. They want to be able to defend up at the tier 3s, while TNC, they don't have an amazing way of pushing forward. You know, Sven has a good amount of armor. They can put the Tombstone down to try and, you know, deter the Radiant from fighting into them. But they want to find a big team fight outside. Oh. They want to find the pickoffs like this. Dazzle dead.
I mean, it's good that he has buyback, but you really can't afford to get picked off like that as a Dazzle, like, period. Like, this is the second fight in a row that they're not going to have him at the beginning unless he buys back, and they can kind of take the fight outside the base unless the Winter Wyvern connects first. Febby, not even positioned to do so. He's TPing back. Raven's going to be counter-pushing QO, then remnanting back forward, and now we're going to see the pressure on this tier 3 directly. Oh, look, X looking out of mana, though.
He gets healed back up with the Greaves. Now March. Oh, man, what? Undying Soul Rip down into the ground. Now the wall is dropped. QO will shoot back through it. Winner's Curse is good. Raven, they take it apart by his teammate, but healed up at the last second. Remnant away. And X Lucky, even with Agency of the Mortal, still bailing out away from this one. Tide is dead. There's a buyback and a Ravage available for him, though. The Dire, they're running out of mana. Aegis is gone. He gets a little regen back from it. X Lucky back up to full. Blinks forward. Looks for the PL, but he's not going to find the stun. Just yet onto him.
Now the Dazzle's back up, but the Tide is not. Them being unwilling to commit buybacks to this makes it much more difficult for them to hold it, but so far so good. No QO getting caught out here. Big combo, but finally the Grave will force them back. Even just, I guess, with the threat of the potential Tide buyback. I don't think they want to fight into that whatsoever, even though actually looking from our kind of bird's eye view here, we see the Tide's TP didn't come off cooldown until just now, and buyback with a TP on cooldown for a hero like Tidehunter is a lot worse than a buyback with a TP available.
Regeneration. Yeah, definitely. Now, we saw TNC, the bit of trouble there, dealing with that counter push from Razors, from Splinter Blast, the heal out from Heon as well. They couldn't take the tier 3, they couldn't quite finish it off, even with the medallion up on the Sven, hitting up on the front lines, he was losing mana, losing HP, and he was always under threat, even with Aegis of the Immortal. But now with the AC, maybe they can actually force the issue here. They still want to find a team fight outside of the base, a couple of pickoffs here and there, but MVP they've been showing for the past, you know, 10 minutes or so, maybe a little bit less, 7 or 8 minutes, that they don't want to fight, they want to split push. The Shadow Fiend and Phantom Lancer have both been on side lanes, pushing away, while they do give up a kill on Heem the Dazzle in middle lane. It's, you know, it's a bit annoying that he dies there. He maybe could have held a little bit stronger at the mid and not lost as much HP on that tier 3. But they're still getting the job done on the side. Like, Mental Protector is up at top lane. He's farming away. He's got BOTs and how much gold? 2,000 gold on top of Manta Diffusal Blade. He's catching up rapidly. He was miles behind Sven and Ember Spirit.
Ooh, X Lucky finds March though. Nice blink jump in. March will not be able to TP away. And now he does not have buyback. He actually bought a plate mail, and that's going to cost him the gold needed to come back into it. They pipe immediately. They don't actually hit the creep wave. Okay, they hit two creeps out of the melee wave. Either way, they're not going to be raised down. X Lucky, already with God's Strength still active, will take one Rax, and yeah, there's no way to defend the second one either. They have to draw the line at the side lanes, and right now they're just pushing as hard as they can.
TNC, do they move up to top now? Yeah, they blink forward. Tier 3 up the top is their goal. As Phantom Lancer is rabid here up on the tier 3 of the zone. But Ember Spirit is ready to defend. He's got the cleave, he's got the crits. Just needs to get the hits in though. Mental Protector burning through his mana with those illusions. Doing a pretty good job at holding Ember back, but tier 3 is defended. There is no trade-off. But the Tombstone drops. But this is just going to be another free lane of Rax. Mental Protector throws out the Lancers. Dodges out that stun with the Doppelganger. But taking out the Tombstone is one thing. Winter's Curse is another. Noji caught. Sam H will drop him with the help of QO. And they do not have the way to turn this around. The vacuum wall onto Shadowfiend is one way, but Grave keeps him up and running. Raven cannot find the final killing blow. Maybe with a Flutter Fist and a Blink stun. Shadowfiend dead. Has to buy back. And Febby in a world of hurt here. Down on the low ground. Underneath his own base. March with the Ravage is ready now. He's here. He has the spell. But there's no one to cast it on. There's no combo to be had. And they've just lost a lane of Rax and a tier 3 up at top.
Yeah, I just can't believe that this game has pretty much been decided by one Ancients pick off. I mean, like, this is such a vulnerable position to be in when you don't have map control, and yet he was right there, got completely caught out by three Ravenhairs. They didn't even have to smell for it. They just ran up to him and gunned him down, and that was so decisive. I mean, March, in my experience, he is one of the more stable players for MVP's roster, but in this case, he makes a dramatic error, and it costs the team of the mid-racks for sure, and the tier 3 top as well. Thank you, Oha.
And if they're banking on this Phantom Lancer, what is the big impact item you buy on a PL? Because he doesn't buy crits, he doesn't buy hexes, he doesn't buy anything of those kinds. He can't just, you know, build stability. You buy stats, you buy heart, butterfly, things that keep you alive and tank your illusions up. Maybe you can cause enough havoc in a team fight to actually go in and battle the Ember and the Sven, but they've got BKBs, they've got cleave and crits, they've got ways of dealing with your illusions and actually hitting you through them.
So yeah, there's no Hail Mary item for a Phantom Lancer. Yeah. Like, he's all about gradual build-up and then it just being really, really strong when there are, like, four or five items in his inventory. The Butterfly is going to be the next item of choice, and it's the correct decision, but, I mean, his power is just getting that much more significant, not, like, as a huge spike, but just in general improvements. And, of course, if the Darkseer gets a hold of his illusion like he's been doing to the Shadow Fiend all game, then he's going to be able to take advantage of those stats as well.
Well, at the very least, MVP get that third Roshan. So Cheese over on the PL, Aegis once again on the Shadow Fiend. Take a look at that. Daedalus done on the Sven. With his AC, he's got a ton of damage. I have to wait and see what he can actually do with it. With a vacuum back into a couple of stuns. The one hero that we really haven't seen too much of, apart from that Laguna Blade on the on the Tidehunter up at top, is the Lina. She's kind of been that unsung hero, casting spells, not getting killed off too many times. She's 1, 5, and 6. Just that slow and steady support that, you know, it's not flashy, doesn't do anything amazing, it's not like the core Lina that goes around zapping people with Laguna Blade. She's just been there, been ready, and the Yule Scepter has come in handy every once in a while.
Yeah, I mean, that's only a recent pickup off the Larax Gold, but I mean, it's definitely a huge pickup for her in terms of setup, and it's going to force BKB very early on the Shadow Fiend, maybe a Doppelganger from the PL. Or, of course, you can just jump on a support that doesn't have those answers. I mean, Winter Wyvern maybe can get the Glimmer Cape off in time, but the Dazzle sure as hell can't do anything about it.
Try and Grave. Phantom Lancer, bot lane. It's like a last-ditch effort. And then Ember Spirit comes in. He's got a Remnant top, right? Yeah. He can just clear the wave of bot, like you said. Push it back out. Stop the PL from gaining any kind of ground. Q-O is very far forward here. Korea from the Radiant flying across with a blink.
Whoa, that's a bluff. That is really just scaring them off without any real backup. I mean, there's the smoke behind him, but not close enough to actually justify that positioning. Now Najee going to go for the TP away, and it looks like he'll just die straight up. Three right clicks, Winter's Curse to be sure, and that is going to be a one dead Lina, which means about another minute or so before we can see another push from TNC. But of course, they're still kind of in the waiting out of the Aegis phase. QO, he knew that he could get that much distance from his supportive staff because he has that Aegis, and because his first life isn't nearly as impactful as his second, but he might not be able to take much advantage of either as the God Strength comes out and QO gets just obliterated. No Blink Dagger means no way out of this.
Yeah. You're screwed. Requiem, Cold Embrace, Vacuum back now. They'll even get Winter Wyvern as another kill on top of everything. Q-O can't even cast his Requiem. And Mental Protector?
The Phantom Lancer's
coming here to fight.
Oh no.
The Phantom Lancer, try and double ganger away. He's going to do something, but he's down and out. That's the Shadow Fiend without buyback. Forever.
Yeah.
2.5 minutes.
I mean, I guess with that being said, the PL's death there isn't really relevant because not only does he have buyback, but they're not going to be able to fight it without the Shadow Fiend. He's just been such an instrumental aspect of all their engagements, but it is just very unfortunate to see it go down this way. A pickoff on the Radiant Ancients for the Tide and a pickoff up top for the Shadow Fiend. Those two decided the game here.
TNC, it looks like they're closing out this game now. Two lanes of racks gone, MVP no real recourse. Come back into this, especially when March has jumped on like that with the Searing Chains. Raven, he's been on top of this game. 9-1-11. Again, it's the one fluke death. March now jumps in, but probably to his own death. Kraken Shell does dispel off that stun, but you'll step it into LSA. That's the combo they're looking for. Back into Grave, Laguna Blade. Okay, March is still alive. He's not dying just yet. He's tanking through it all, and with the Greaves, he'll get himself back up to Good amount of health, but I've lost the tier 4s. Secondary tier 4 is falling, and Shadow Fiend's dead for 36 seconds. At this point, they're talking about game 2, right? The PL not buying back here, they're just letting the game kind of pan out as it is, and there's the GG. Talking about game 2, talking about how to come back into this series. Of course, it's best of 3. March, Constellation Ravage. Get in there with a 5-man Ravage, of course. But yeah, that's game number 1, guys, of the best of 3 of the ESL 1 at New York. Southeast Asian qualifiers, the first semi-final. MVP up against TNC. I'm Durka, joining me Blaze. We'll be back in a couple of minutes with game number 2 and after a short little break.